film, television, and interactive media, mostly focusing on interactive media these days. To my right is Jeff Yaw. He's a senior producer at Think Media Studios, which is a production company based in Cleveland. It was founded in 2004. They have such notable clients as Cleveland Cavaliers, Playhouse Square, University of Akron, among many others. Think Media Studios also has produced many documentaries, award-winning documentaries, three of which were directed by Jeff Yaw. So his film this year in the festival is A More Civil War, but he's also directed King Me and a documentary on Playhouse Square.
That title's hard to say, isn't it? A More Civil War.
A More Civil War.
It looks great on the page. It's hard to say with your mouth.
Well, that makes it even better, doesn't it? I don't know.
You tell me.
I don't know. Your diary's crazy. We'll find out. All right. So next to Jeff, we have Evan Lieberman. Evan is, of course, our very own associate professor at CSU School of Films. School of Communication right now, soon to be School of Film, Television, and Interactive Media. Have you been following the news? Yeah, very soon we will be becoming the School of Film, Television, and Interactive Media, or some kind of permutation of that name, as the name becomes solidified. Evan has been teaching at CSU for 10 years. He's an accomplished filmmaker and musician. He has his MFA in screenwriting from USC and a PhD in film studies from Emory.
American Film Institute.
I'm sorry. Thank you.
Wow. This guy knows what he's doing. AFI.
Thank you for the correction. So we're AFI and a PhD from Emory. He's worked in a number of films, started his career in documentaries, and nowadays working on a new documentary. And that is Jen. We don't have our little...
No, we didn't do it this year. No. 2 years ago, people made fun of it.
What was it?
We had thought bubbles.
We had bubbles with their names. And so, some of the filmmakers were goofing on it, and it made me self-conscious.
Jen Poland is a local filmmaker and a film educator here in Cleveland as well. She's worked as a lecturer at Cleveland State University and also has taught Artworks. Are you familiar with Artworks?
Great program.
Our wonderful youth art education program that we have in Cleveland. So she's a great member of the film community in Cleveland and has a lot to contribute for sure. So she and Evan are working on a new film that we will discuss very soon. Last but not least, we have John Morlis, of course, the director of Breaking Balls, which premiered at Cleveland International Film Festival this
year. See, that's fun to say.
There you go.
That rolls right off the tongue, so to speak.
That's funny. You know what?
Good job, John.
Thank you. You're my hero. You say that is awesome.
You know, I didn't have a question prepared for titles of documentaries, but I think that might be a good one. So maybe we'll go there. What to name your doc?
Yeah, let's break some balls. Let's do it.
There you go. John Morlis is a Cleveland native. He's the one with the MFA from USC in script writing, not AFI.
Film production.
right. Also a lecturer at Cleveland State University. He spent about 20 years in LA working in the film industry. Returned to Cleveland about 7 years ago. The boomerang was come back,
yes,
right?
Yes, it must.
All right. And Breaking Balls is his first documentary.
First
that I know
feature,
of.
First documentary, first holy smokes.
All right. Okay, so let's get started. I'm going to start with an easy question. I thought that it would be more accurate if I asked you guys to introduce your film that is currently in the film festival and also in production very briefly, and then we'll go to questions from there. Sound good?
Mm-hmm. Sure, that's great. We're starting with me?
Yes.
A More Civil War is a movie, a little bit of an experiment, and we can get into that later, where we took the 4 days of the Republican National Convention and we embedded with activists, journalists, political pundits, and a couple of other types of people who followed their journey through the 4 days of the Republican National Convention. So we ran 4 crews simultaneously, 1 inside the convention, 3 outside the convention, and tried to fashion what is ultimately an art film about politics that explores the theme of American exceptionalism and whether or not that is in fact a thing anymore.
Cool, thank you. And Evan and Jen, I'm going to add, I forgot in the introduction. So if you know Evan and Jen, you know Kiss Me Deadly. They are also very active members of the Cleveland music scene. members of the band Kiss Me Deadly. Evan plays bass for the band, and Jen is a singer-songwriter. And I wanted to sort of interject that because the film that they're working on has something to do with it. So go ahead.
The film that we're currently working on is called True Voice, and it grew out of our experience with a local singer-songwriter composer named Brent Kirby. And Brent is just an amazing person. He's one of the few people in Cleveland who makes a living as an original artist, as an original musician, but he works so incredibly hard. And one of the things that he does is he organizes a singer-songwriter showcase, or a songwriter showcase, on Wednesday nights at Brothers Lounge, that he calls the 10x3, in which we have 10 acts or singer-songwriters who each get 3 songs, 2 of which must be original. And from the 10x3, we have seen this extraordinary community develop with people forming bands with one another, recording with one another, giving one another gigs, doing all of that. And we wanted to document how a musical community develops, what is the dynamic that allows something like this to flourish. And a lot of it has to do with the kind of person Brent Kirby is. So he's at the center of the documentary, but we have a lot of musical performances in there. And I think we're pretty much finished shooting the musical performances. We still have a couple more interviews to do. And then it's time to put the story together, which, as we will discuss, is all that shooting that we've been doing for over a year, that's the easy part.
Yeah.
Right? Now comes the tough part.
Oh my God. Yeah.
By the way, if you ever meet a documentary filmmaker, they will always say, I have a couple more interviews to shoot. It's like a standard documentary. I can tell you I have a couple more interviews to shoot for my movie that's about to screen in 3 hours. It's a pretty common theme.
It sure is.
You know, another thing done. I would say is that it feels weird. I'm also a documentary filmmaker, and it feels weird. Currently, I have nothing to edit, and that's a very strange situation to be in.
How does that happen?
Yeah.
Partly because I didn't shoot when I should have. But it's, you know, there's always work in terms of, you know, things that are coming out there, you have to shoot, things that are, that you have to edit. In my case, for the most part, it is like gigabytes of footage that you have to deal with.
Yeah.
But
fortunately, I don't have to edit. Jen does all the editing.
Very good. Make good friends with Jen and work really well.
She's way better at it than I am, that's for sure.
Did you want to add to Emma's intro of the film, or do you want to chime in later?
I'll chime in later.
All right. And John?
My film is called Breaking Balls, as we've all said. I'm not a documentary filmmaker. I come from the narrative world, and we'll get into why I'm a documentary filmmaker, and I'm sure in a little bit. But the movie is about bocce and the Italian game of bocce, which some people know as lawn bowling. When I grew up in Wycliffe is a suburb just east of Cleveland that's full of Italian Americans. Almost all of them, children or direct immigrants from this little area called Campo Basso in southeast Italy. And they are really, really passionate about their bocce to the point where they have created this festival around the game at the Wycliffe Italian American Club, which goes on the last weekend of August every year. And when I moved back to from Los Angeles to Cleveland 7 years ago, I really wasn't thinking about bocce or documentary filmmaking. And a friend of mine who knew this community pretty well just called me up one night in August and said, hey, you want to go see a bocce tournament down at the INA? And I thought, why not, right? I mean, it's a beautiful summer night and I'm going to either sit on the couch or go out. And I thought I was going to see a bunch of old Italian men, you know. I mean, if you've grown up in Cleveland, you know what I'm talking about. And and I got down there and I was gobsmacked. I had this is 5 blocks from the house I grew up in, and there's thousands of people down there. 9 immaculately covered bocce courts, a huge food festival going on, drinking, eating. I mean, I had never seen anything like it in my life. And I turned to my friend and I said, what the hell's going on here? And he said, I told you, it's bocce. Uh-huh. And I said, well, somebody's got to make a movie about this because this the community is too, it's too spectacular.
Yeah, I kind of want to add a question there right away to you, John. Because, Breaking Balls is about bocce and it's about Italian-American community, about the Italian-American community in Cleveland. But it's a really good example of this. Okay, when we teach film and we teach writing, we always ask this question, like, what's the story about?
Yeah.
And then you say, what's the story really about? Right? Yeah, it's about the Italian-American community, but what is it really about? Like, how would you answer that?
I would answer that by saying that it took me 4 years to figure that out. Mm-hmm. Evan wasn't kidding. The easy part is the shooting part. For me, I was incredibly lucky. I met Evan at a film commission mixer right about the time I moved back, and we became drinking buddies and followed his band around. Met Jen, totally supportive of one of the great local bands in Cleveland, and we were up on the patio. Evan has a kind of a cool apartment that's way up on one of the tall buildings down the street here, and we were sitting just yammering away about, and I was complaining about whatever I was complaining about, and I said, I need to find something to do. I came back to Cleveland, I'm a filmmaker, I don't know how to do anything else, I'm here to take care of my parents, and Evan said, oh, it's too bad you can't teach film. And I'm like, what do you mean people teach? Well, I went to film school, I mean, I knew that. And I said, I'm sure I could teach film, and then he started explaining to me why I couldn't do it, and why he wished I could do it, and then I finally said, well, I think I meet all those qualifications, actually. Mm-hmm. And he said, oh man, that's awesome, because we need somebody to start in 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And he said, send me your resume, and I'll send it to George Ray, who's a great man, and 30 minutes later, I get this text saying, do you have references? Because if you do, we're just going to give you a job. I had no idea what I was doing. I walked into that, and then I met all these great kids who were so passionate about making film.
Right.
And I thought, well, I want to make a movie too. You know? I mean, I did go to film school. I didn't spend 20 years in Hollywood. And even though I was a little jaded, frankly, when I came back, I got so excited that I just
jumped into it. I think it's a good segue to friendship and community, right?
Oh, my
Which
God.
I think is, like, when I looked at your film, yes, it was about the Italian-American community, but it really, what the story was about was true friendship, true community, the connection between
family, tradition, couillons.
Right, and it's really wonderful to hear that sort of connection or community is what you find in the teaching community at CSU as well.
Yeah.
So let's get into it, guys. My first question, well, I guess second, first and a half, is this.
Question 1.5.
1.5, all right. Let's talk about evolution of concept of story. You know, we always start, let's make a documentary about such and such, right? That's a concept, but what is a story? So how does your story, how does your film evolve from that concept into that story? When do you find the characters? How do you determine the story arc? Is it all in the editing, or is it something that was in beforehand? So if you could talk about it in your own film and your own experience, the evolution of concept into story.
Sure. So in a more civil war, I had a couple of known variables. I knew that the RNC was coming to town. I knew that it was going to last 4 days. And I knew that I wanted to do it as a very verite piece of embedded journalism. So once I knew that, I had that big ball of clay, the question becomes, as you sort of imply, who do we embed with? What stories do we want to tell? When you look at Cleveland, it's really a microcosm of a lot of the deepest divisions that we have as a nation. We have African-American versus police issues in this town. We have economic disparity, like you find in many urban centers in the country. So I knew those issues existed. I didn't know if they were going to be talking about them on the stage of the RNC. So we started to find characters that were emblematic. The other thing was it was very important for me that we embed with pro-Trump people as well as anti-Trump. Anti-Trumpers are easy to find. The pro-Trump people were actually the most difficult people to connect with. So there were a few things that I knew that I wanted to bring out. I am not a pro-Trump person myself, but I also felt like during that period of time that people that were pro-Trump were being unfairly characterized, especially in social media. So we tried very hard to find people who weren't cartoon characters, who were people that you could relate to and on some level understand why they would support a candidate like Donald Trump. I think we have some success in that. And this movie is kind of unique in that you don't have one protagonist. You know, John has several protagonists in his movie. I have about five. Mm-hmm. And you're following them and how they intersect through these 4 days. So in terms of how we went from concept to finished product, and I think your question is, how does that change? Mm-hmm. It changed pretty significantly. We end up, in the finished product of A More Civil War, we end up talking about race much more than I ever intended to. I think we ended up connecting with characters that were so strong in person and are so strong on screen. And as these guys can attest, once you start putting it together, you use the best stuff that you have and you fashion the story, because in the end, the title of the film is an aspirational title. The word Civil War was being used so frequently in the lead up to the RNC and during this election. And it's really a plea on my part for more civility. So my end goal from concept to creation was to create a piece of film that encouraged people, as kumbaya as it might sound, to listen to each other. Mm-hmm. And my version of that is to present each side of each issue and hope that each side can come to some understanding.
Thank you.
Does that answer the question?
That sure does answer the question. Thank you.
I'm pretty good at not answering questions. So
just like most of our interviews. Yeah.
I'm pretty good at finding the answers. And
good. I'll leave that to you.
Jen, as the primary editor, right? Do you want to kind of talk about, so we're talking about, you know, evolution of concept to story, and you guys had a character already, right? So how does that work in this film that you're working on?
So we have a character, and it's kind of funny because, like, you have to work with your characters as well. So, like, as far as filming goes, he's kind of learning how much we have to film him and follow him around with the camera and go to different. Because part of the story is we want to film his journey of trying to take his 10x3 world. He's nurturing all these musicians, and he's developing a culture where everybody connects and is able to share. And then he's trying to, like, bring it out into the community where these guys have more direct lines to get out. And play. Now that's a challenge and that's the hurdle. So I was like, okay, I'm gonna have to follow you around with the camera, you know. And he's like, what? You know, I'm like, well, I can't just be a bunch of talking heads. I have to, like, stalk you down with this camera. And so he's right now we're kind of teaching him that he's our main character. So like he's down with it, but he's like, wait a minute, what?
That's always a fun conversation.
Oh my God, yeah.
Thursday he's playing at a retirement home, and Jenny is going to go follow him, because he played anywhere. That's one of the things that's interesting about this film, is that here's this guy, he's got multiple records out, he's well known, very highly regarded, and you can see him at a farmer's market,
yeah,
right?
Street.
At noon. But then at 3, he's going to be at a happy hour somewhere. And at 7,
he's at the bus station.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Which is how one makes a living as a musician. Now, this particular gig, retirement home. Mm-hmm. And so Jenny was like, oh, yeah, I'm going to come with you there. He's like, what? It's like, no.
And then I said, I'm going to come with you at night when you go to your next gig. And I'm going to start filming you everywhere you go. And he's like,
Have you told him not to look into the camera?
Oh yeah,
no, actually, that's always
that's training too. We're training him on that as well. But yeah, so it's so that's right now. It's like the struggle is working with our character and getting him okay with the fact we're gonna stalk them more, and then
because like that word stalk.
Well, we got all these other interviews of other so people true. To help talk. All the musicians, yeah. We've got all this footage of performances, which you can actually see some of them online. They're already promoting the movie already, and then. Yeah, the footage.
Right.
I got an idea of what I want to do, but it's once I get it all in there, I got to find the sound bites that I like, I got to put the story together. I mean, I don't even know where it's going to fall right
now. You guys have a really great starting kernel, though, because it's basically him and his passion and his struggle, and you just said it. What it takes to make a living as a musician in a city like Cleveland. Mm-hmm. It's a great place to start. You're in a really good spot.
What you said is, I think, is super important. It's you got to find that one kernel. And it has to be a seed. It can't be a rock, because rocks don't grow. Right? if it's a seed and you see it and you can see what it's going to look like when it's a full-fledged plant, The job is to try to nurse it to the point where you don't kill it, right?
Without being too controlling.
Yeah.
It's like you have that roadmap. It's almost a fallback,
yeah.
Because you'll always have opportunities that come up that will be like, that's over here. Do I pay attention to it? I don't know.
Right.
And is it a blind alley? It's tough. There's a lot of like decisions that have to happen, whether or not you choose to expend your resources of time on something that may or may not turn out to be something. And sometimes they bear fruit, to throw back to your metaphor, and sometimes they don't.
Yeah.
And it's a very organic process, unlike narrative filmmaking, which is a very kind of artificial process, right? Narrative filmmaking is all about reconstructing reality in the image in your mind and having great control over it. What this is about is looking for the moment and keeping that camera rolling on stuff, because you don't know when the moment's going to happen, and you don't know when the moment that's going to define your film is going to be. And
that's so, for sure.
And as a result, it just demands so much shooting, so much watching.
Right.
You know, and a lot of times you shoot something, you don't even realize it's valuable until you shoot something else.
Until 4 years later. When you're like, I need that one shot for B-roll. Where the hell is it?
Yeah.
I love the
kernel metaphor. You know, it's thinking about kernels that are essentially going to grow into larger aspects of stories, right? And of course, you can have kernels that don't pop sometimes.
Yeah.
If you've ever made popcorn.
So she went popcorn, nice.
Yeah.
I know the metaphors are getting thick here. I
got another one for you. Because at the end of the day, we're all making a movie. If you're a documentary filmmaker, you're making a movie. If you're a narrative filmmaker, you're making a movie. The audience no longer is really differentiating much between documentary and narrative. The world is a blur of that, this whole fake news thing. And I was trained as a narrative filmmaker. I spent my whole life writing scripts, understanding structure, doing all this. And so when I wanted to set out to make a movie from Cleveland, I go east. And I want to get to Nepal. Nepal is the movie. And I know how to get there going east. I know the route to fly to New York, to Delhi, to take it, and then get it. Making a documentary, it was like traveling west. To go all the way around the world to end up in the same place. Never went west before. No idea what's there. There's a Grand Canyon. Holy crap. Rocky Mountains. How do you get over that? The Pacific Ocean, wider than the Atlantic? Oh man, I'm never gonna get there. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, what I learned was that the things that you can count on to tell a story, the medium is irrelevant. The genre is irrelevant. There's this structure to storytelling. And if you understand that, and you don't just pay lip service to it, you can take those 200 hours of footage that are terrifying you and start to shape a piece that tells a story. Because if you don't tell a story, and this was the hardest thing for us, we had three main characters. I knew where we were culminating. We were culminating at this big tournament. But to find the narrative arc of that was a 4-year slog through the jungle with machetes and large animals trying to kill you.
But you made it, man.
Yeah, that's a relief as much as anything. And I
think it's actually one of the strongest aspects of the film is the editing, how meticulously, carefully, artfully it has been woven together. You can tell that it has taken a long time.
Alone is going to be here at the next panel.
And I think that, you know, aren't our challenges also our strengths, right? So I think that opportunities. So I think that has also helped strengthen the story of the film. That like the care and the effort and the time it took to put that together is what makes it so powerful, I think.
You can't shortchange that.
Right.
Jeff knows.
But I want to. I wouldn't fly direct.
Yeah, the direct flight's always the best one. But we all can't afford that direct flight, you know. As independent filmmakers, we gotta get to New York and then hope the New York flight leaves.
We're flying standby all the time.
All the time.
the plane is not overbooked and
hope
what
our,
have you.
Hope our visa that gets us into
yes.
India
is love,
into the Republican National
We
convention.
Love metaphors, don't we?
We're like
this
all
is
about
funny.
It today.
It's yeah. The world is round and there's not only one way to get no. from one place to
That's
another.
So true.
Hey, we should right. get back to this plan.
You know, but I'm going to get to the real stuff now. We're going to talk money.
Oh.
All right, let's talk money. Let's talk about funding. Because, you know, each of the three films that we're discussing today have different modes of funding, different styles of funding. When I introduced Jeff, I mentioned that he works for Think Media Studios, who was essentially the body behind the film as well, right? So what's the funding process like for you? What's the process like for you? And I have a feeling John kind of paid for his film. What is,
I'll tell you the process.
Right, right. So let's.
He still owes me money.
I owe him beer for sure.
So let's talk money, shall we?
Yeah, like you said, I work for a production, a commercial production company. You know, I'm a commercial director for hire. That's what I do for a living. It's a fairly large organization. There's 20 of us. If you stick around for the editorial panel next, you'll meet a couple of my colleagues as well. So the funding process for this movie is partially self-funded by the company. Partially funded by outside investors, that you take that concept that we talked about and you go, hey, I have this crazy idea where I want to make an art film about politics over the course of 4 days. Will you please write me a check? Pretty, pretty please. And some of them say no and some of them say yes. So my funding story is probably a little less exciting than John's is. But
a little less terrifying.
You know, it's one of the single hardest things about being a filmmaker is letting people make you having people allow you to do this thing that you do. Mm-hmm. It's an enormous hurdle. It has been for my entire career. I happen to be fortunate right now where I have resources in this production company that I work for. So things like editorial, mm-hmm. I'm not on my own with. Mm-hmm. I participate. The first thing I ever got paid to do in this business was as an editor. So mm-hmm. it's something that comes very naturally to me and it helps me as a director as well. But, I guess, and you know, myself versus John, mm-hmm. I have it a lot easier than him
right.
in terms of that stuff because I have some resources that he doesn't have.
Now, do you mind if I go into nitty gritty a little bit?
So, sure. Can I say no comment?
Yeah, absolutely. and if it is too detailed, but I think that
sure.
sometimes getting into specifics are helpful for people.
Sure, absolutely.
Who
yeah,
work
go for
at
it.
Production companies. So you have crew, you have equipment, you have
mm-hmm.
post-production gear,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
So then when you make a budget, you always have to make a budget, right, to raise
yes.
funds. When you start with a budget.
Yes.
And so what aspect of that budget was funded by private investors, would you say?
I mean, I would say 50% of the film is internal cost and 50% is external. But we do interesting things. When a project like this comes up, we say, okay, we're going to take this budget and we're going to make it as an investment. I knew the cameras that I wanted to shoot this film in. I really liked the new Blackmagic Ursa Mini that came out this year.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful 4K camera.
Mm-hmm.
It's really made well for run and gun stuff. It has
mm-hmm.
an amazing image that comes out of it. We owned one of them.
Mm-hmm.
We purchased three more
okay.
that are now part of our inventory. So we used that budget wisely and said we're gonna treat it as an investment
mm-hmm.
in the company, so that we're not because I didn't have enough. We didn't own the right kind of cameras
mm-hmm.
for me to shoot it all with the inventory that we had production wise.
Mm-hmm.
So we just took the opportunity and made an investment in the company with the budget.
So you acquired more equipment that was more appropriate for this. And we can talk about this later on, but like if you have any students here, you know, getting your film to the festival for screening, a lot of times you have to get a DCP, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's something they have to provide, and that's sometimes $5,000 or more, perhaps, depends on where you get it done.
It's reduced over the years. I think you can get a good DCP for about $1,000 right now.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
Okay.
The festival here doesn't require it.
These guys don't require
it. We did an Apple ProRes.
Yeah.
So you just gave them a ProRes file.
Yeah,
I've been
screening
for ProRes.
I was thrilled.
And I apologize if we're getting too into nitty-gritty sort of technical specifics, but we'll move on to more perhaps an audience can relate to. But these are also very specific questions, so if you have anything like that, those are the kinds of questions that I always have for filmmakers at the end. So you'll have an opportunity to ask, so think about them.
You guys just went down a nerd hole.
I'm fishing us back up. We're climbing out of the nerd hole now. Okay, and we're going to talk about funding, money, right? How are you guys handling it?
Well, my first documentaries I made for a production company called Churchill Films, and so they were paid for. You know, we had budgets and expenses and all of that stuff. It was really very nice in a way, because what wasn't so nice is that at the end of the day, it's their film, not our film, right? And as a result, we had to. In the films I made for Churchill, none of them are exactly what I would have liked. They won awards and stuff, and way to go. But nonetheless, when somebody when it's a work for hire like that, you don't have a lot necessarily a lot to say. Jenny and I spent 2 years on another music documentary project, only to have the producer of the project decide that we were not the people to do it, and got somebody else. And so we had spent 2 years working, and then they wanted our footage. But fortunately, they hadn't actually paid us significantly, and so we were like, no, you can't have our footage. But this one, we started just on our own. And it's an interesting thing about financing documentary. Very often, you don't finance documentary from the get-go. You don't finance it from step one. Step one is we go out and we shoot and we amass material and we will develop a cut, or not an entire cut of the film, maybe a 5 or 8 minute segment of the film that really gives a flavor of what we're going for, at which point we can now go seek seek grant financing. It's really difficult in the documentary world to seek grant financing without something already having been done. Right? You have to have a piece of it in a way. And so, but once you do have a piece of it, now you can start looking for money for finishing.
Right?
And that would be the kind of thing that we would do.
You know, we should do a whole panel on funding.
Next year. Isn't it the primary concern of all these filmmakers?
You know, it's a very expensive world out there, and we're not independently wealthy, unfortunately. So
it's the single biggest hurdle. I mean, it's the single biggest hurdle to filmmaker.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of them, but it's a big one.
You know, I have a good Dante question, but let's hear from John and
I will say this: when I said I was not a documentary filmmaker, I wasn't kidding. I'm a writer first, and luckily I met Evan and Jen. And when I came back here, and I went to SC Film School, and then I directed my little SC things, and I was, you know, some of them I liked a lot, some of them not so much. And when I came back here, the three of us were like, we gotta start doing some shit, because these kids are so excited. I had a friend who wrote a short story. I loved it. I thought, man, we could do this. I gave it to Jen. Jen and Evan sat down and wrote a expanded version. It turned out it was about 20 pages long. And then I was gonna direct it, and they were gonna produce it. Evan shot it. And the experience was fantastic. The film is okay. Some of it's really good, but I had so much fun working on it with Evan and Jen, and the crew of people that I was working with was almost all students from here. And I thought, wow, this might be a way to make a movie. Couldn't make a feature that way, but might be able to make a documentary that way.
People try.
Yeah, they try, and God bless them. Some of them make it, and some of them live. And I've seen them fall by the wayside all the time, and I'm like, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to go into a feature with no money. But I got this idea for a documentary, and I don't have any money. I literally was broke, flat broke. And I thought, you only live once, right? I am a film person. I'm a filmmaker. Even if I'm a writer, I want to make this movie. And I have no money, so how am I going to do it? So I started reaching out to these students that had just recently graduated, that I were in my classes, that I thought had enough talent as camera people or whatever to get involved, and I was lucky with two or three of them. And we went and made a movie with $0 in the production budget, nothing, not a penny. I occasionally bought them breakfast or lunch. I promised them credit in the film, and if you see the poster, there are 6 cinematographers who get above the title credit, all from here. But they were so gung-ho
you know, that that we got it done. And then we had a lot of footage. And as Evan said, and Jeff will attest, you know, that's the easy part. You cannot get anybody to edit your film for nothing. Except maybe yourself. And I tried, and I was not successful because I'm not an editor. I can edit words all day long. I can slice and dice words like nobody's business. But when I look at the visual images of the people that I have photographed and followed around for 4 years, I love all of them. And I cannot make a 200-hour long film. No one will watch it. So I realized in the most painful, horrible way that I was going to actually have to go raise money. And Jeff's been with me from the beginning of this project, because when I decided to do this, I'm like, who do I know that's made documentaries in town? Jeff from King Me, which I screened in class once. Great film about Jeffy. Here's how good Jeff is as a filmmaker. He made a movie about checkers, and it kicks ass. Go see it. It's fantastic.
But what's the movie really about? Is it about checkers?
Jeff,
or is it
about post-apartheid South African life. I'm not kidding.
It is, and he's right.
And I think there's a powerful question about films in general. You know, it's not always about the plot, right? It's what's underneath it.
That's where
the power lies.
But you got to have that narrative. If you don't have that narrative, that plot structure, the audience will tune out. They're used to having stories told to them. And the editor in film and documentaries is the storyteller. Mm-hmm. The editor is the writer. And as a writer, that was a problem, because my first editor, who was a very successful documentary filmmaker, we didn't agree on the story. And I had spent $15,000 of all the money that I had raised. And I am not a salesman. I'm not great at raising money. And I had nothing left and no movie. Mm-hmm. And that's a scary, scary place to be.
Yeah.
And but Jeff, like, you know, he'll figure it out. Jeff's like the most encouraging. If you want to have a friend in the film business, it's got to be a guy like Jeff. Because Jeff doesn't see problems. Jeff sees solutions. And that's, I think, the true nature of independent film, right? I mean, Evan is the same way, and Jen is the same way. If you give Jen 20 hours of film and tell her to make a 20-minute movie, she'll figure it out. And and that's what documentary, and then, so I figured it out. I got lucky.
So you raised money, right? So
I raised some more money. I met some people through a student that I had worked with who was working at a media company that did almost exclusively post-production work. Mm-hmm. They were exactly the people I needed to show up at that time in the process. And when they got involved, it took from the start to the finish 5.5 months, and we had a movie that year.
That's really great.
And it was
excellent.
A miracle.
As much as I hate to interrupt this episode of Jeff is Awesome.
But it's true.
John is a really great example of the passion and the stick-to-itiveness that it takes to make a movie like that. He's been through a lot of making this movie, and you did it, man. Like, it's really cool.
Yeah, it's a good feeling to finally get to the finish line.
This is when you celebrate, right? This is when you kind of put it behind you, all the challenges, and this is when it's done, on to the next thing.
It's also an example of just when you think, I'm a big believer in things that are meant to be, as spacey as that might sound. This movie was meant to be. Things just started happening at the right time, and it really was a struggle.
It was meant to take 4 years.
Yeah,
It wouldn't have been the same story without
you. You could have so easily, so many times, walked away from it, though. There were so many opportunities for you to be like, excuse me, fuck it.
Yeah.
I'm over this.
No, I said those words literally.
This is YouTube. Come on.
Sorry, YouTube. Sorry.
It's live.
I've been pretty good. Usually when I teach class, I swear a little bit more than I should.
So yeah, me too.
I'm not afraid of
it. I don't ever.
I should point out one thing, though. The movie that we all made together, Jen actually produced. I didn't really produce that.
Evan shot it.
She also wrote it. We co-wrote it, and I was director of photography. Mm-hmm. But Jen was the producer. She made it happen.
And editor.
No.
Did you edit it?
No, Jody edited it.
No.
Elson.
Oh, Josh Elson. Yeah. That's what happens when you get old.
And just to speak a little, just for a moment to what Jeff said, it's like when you, in documentary filmmaking, and actually in all filmmaking, it's true in narrative filmmaking as well, like fate, you know, or serendipity is your co-producer. Always,
yeah.
Right? Because
in the whole business. Right?
But don't tell that to your funder,
right? Yeah. They all have a plan.
They have to think you're completely in control. Plan, yeah. But honestly, the best things that are going to happen are almost never going to be what you planned. Mm-hmm. They are always going to be something else, mm-hmm. where you look at it and you're like, damn, mm-hmm. I'm going to tell people I thought of that. Mm-hmm. And I tell my students, as soon as people see it, you're like, I did that on purpose, right? Everything is on purpose, except for that we know that's not how it works. And but there's a way that as a filmmaker, documentary maybe more than narrative, you have to be open to this, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. You have to be paying attention to fate and to, you know, and seeing where it's taking you. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you could be too focused on your vision and be like, that's not part of it. And when you say that's not part of it, what you're doing is cutting off the pathway that may lead you to what would be the best film that you have in your footage.
No question.
So it's really, like, I would add, you know, sort of chime in on that, which is echoing what you just said, is essentially having a good plan, but be ready to abandon the plan.
Yeah.
But if you show up with no plan,
yeah, you're.
That is not screwed. A good plan.
That is Jeff said.
You need a plan that you'll just put in there. You know, you know where my plans go. I always fold them up and put them in my back pocket. And I find them when I do laundry.
or they really, turn into totally. Those weird little pieces of
right. And, but it's kind of funny because it is the physical manifestation of the plan, you know. And then do you follow it? If I were trying to follow all these questions one by one, I don't think it would have as organic and interesting of a conversation. But if you let it evolve a little bit, it's interesting to see where it goes, I think. But with that, I'm gonna go to a question. Okay, I'm gonna follow the plan. Yeah, sure, we'll actually open it to you, audience, but if you think that it's more appropriate to ask at this moment, go ahead.
No matter the topics that you choose, I wonder if there are any topics for documentaries which are off limits. And if there's some topics which probably have been done again and again and again, like say climate change, for instance, could you just say something about that?
I can speak on the again and again and again. You know, I made a movie about politics during a year when you could not turn away from politics. So the question that I got a lot was, why does anybody care about this thing that you're doing? And when you're traveling well-tread territory, you have to find different ways to approach that subject matter. My version of that was to not try to throw a net over the entire election season and to say, I'm shooting for these 4 days. I'm gonna take a snapshot of these 4 days mm-hmm. in Cleveland and how that is reflective of what's happening in the rest of the country, because there are much more well-qualified journalists and news organizations that are gonna do a much more in-depth job of uncovering every nook and cranny. I'm gonna settle in with real people as they experience these 4 days, and in so doing, try to explain what's happening in the nation.
But they didn't know Cleveland the way you knew Cleveland. And I think that shows.
Journalists, yeah.
People came in here with, you know, they were looking at a much broader picture of, and they were missing the story. I mean, they missed it all the way up until the election. Nobody thought Trump was gonna win, but if you watch that
I didn't
movie,
either, by the way.
I know, but if you watch his film, which was filmed during those 4 days, there's a kind of a scary inevitability to that win, and I think that's something that really, you only see it later. You don't see it when you're in.
It's interesting to watch now because we know what we know now. That's what I was banking on, and I feel like it paid off, so I'm glad for that. The other thing that I'll say is I don't think the fact that it's well-worn, you know, something that's been done before subject matter-wise is a good enough reason to not do it. Mm-hmm. You know, there was a period of time, probably 5 or 6 years ago, where everybody needed to make a food documentary. There were so many fucking food documentaries, it was insane. But there are a handful of them that are awesome. You know what I mean? That I was like, oh wow, I didn't want to watch this food documentary, but this is one of the best ones. You know what I mean?
So about the execution.
There's a meritocracy usually in play where if you make something of quality, if the gods are in your favor, it percolates to the surface and people see it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah. So is anything off topic?
Jen,
so, is there anything that isn't worth documenting or something?
No, it's off limits.
Off limits.
As an individual, I don't believe anything's off limits, but I think that that's an individual filmmaker's decision.
Right.
But you also have to keep in mind that if there's something really, really, really disturbing, weird, or strange, your audiences aren't going to really want to see it, I feel. Or they will.
Yeah.
Which is maybe even more disturbing and strange.
I mean, it's about finding your niche, right? I mean, who would imagine, I mean, I in my all my years of filmmaking, the last, in my training, in my whatever, the last movie I thought I would make is a movie about bocce. I made it, and then I thought no one except these people at the Wycliffe INA are going to watch this movie. And that's totally wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, your audience will find you. If you make a good film and you get it out there, you need one person to like it, and then 20 people will like it, and those 20 people would turn it into 400, and so, you know.
And I would say this about the execution. About the off-limits idea. To me, if it's off-limits, then it's a perfect subject for a documentary.
Yeah,
because that limit is a built-in dramatic conflict.
Yeah.
Right? And it's a cultural conflict that's resonant with people. And obviously this is being off limits, it is something that you should discuss.
It's a great place.
That said, I don't always want to see anything. A guy I know, named Rob DeVore, he made a film called Zoo about 5 or 6 years ago. That it was about, let's just say, men who like horses too much. And
but it's a good movie.
Zoo is
great movie.
Is amazing, and I don't want to watch it.
Yeah.
And yet, amazing, it's and fascinating, and disturbing. Great cinema.
That's the thing, if you do it well,
right.
Because it is, when you hear it explained, you're like, there's no way I want to watch that movie.
Yeah.
But the way that film is constructed, it's great. Has anybody here seen a newish documentary called Tickled?
Oh, I heard about it.
Another example. It's about a men's tickling ring, which like, what the hell is that?
Isn't it at CIFF last year?
Yes, it did screen at CIFF last year.
It was in the festival last year. And also, I think that a good way to sort of, a good thing to add to this conversation is, have you ever seen Triumph of the Will by Lynn Riefenstahl?
Or how about Night and Fog?
Off-limits topics, not the propaganda, is not today, this is something that we wouldn't watch, perhaps it wouldn't even be allowed, but you know, freedom of speech is an elusive subject sometimes, right?
And
even if you are able to produce it, sometimes you're, there is backlash, there is reaction to the information that's produced. But if it is made well enough, as Jeff said, Triumph of the Will is something that we use in our classes today, you know, as an educational tool. It has nothing to, I mean, you know, when we talk about it, we don't really talk about Nazi Germany so much. We really talk about the way the film visually tells the story. So, is anything off limits? Guess not. You know?
It depends on how you approach it, because if you're approaching something like that in a tasteful way, and you're presenting, Zoo is probably the best example you could have come up with, because the way that they tell that story, it's just really compelling, and you sort of, you don't ignore the implications of that case, which are horrific, but it's just, you know, you do it well and people will watch it.
Yeah.
It's beautifully shot.
It really is.
It's very kind of sympathetic to its subjects.
Yep.
It has a point of view that you would never see anywhere else.
Yep.
And I think that freshness of point of view often comes from confronting taboo subjects, right? That when you take on something that is scary or it's a little dicey, then you're going to bring a perspective to it that's fresh because, you know, this is something that's not talked about.
Right.
I think that idea of sympathy, being sympathetic in a very philosophical way is super important in documentary filmmaking.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the movie that I made about these people could have been, I could have made fun of them. These people are obsessed with bocce. I mean, it's a little strange when you think about it, to have built this whole culture around this. And I wasn't for a second, didn't find it funny at all. I found it totally endearing. I completely understood why they did it. And it was my job, I felt, passionately felt, it was my job to not make this, look at how funny they are doing their funny thing. It was to get you to feel like, you know what? I think I want to go play bocce. Mm-hmm. And that's just like in politics. I mean, it's like, or in music, you know, you want to get
participate.
The audience needs to participate as much as sit back and watch.
This year's opening night film. I don't know if anybody saw it, California Typewriter, but this was a movie I was so not looking forward to seeing. But then, in my capacity as director of the school, I felt like I had to go and do this, and intensely moved by this film. I never thought a documentary about typewriters could be in any way interesting. Yeah. And I found myself completely captivated, and part of it was because of how much we loved the characters in it. Yeah. That is what mattered to me. Not that it was about typewriters, but that it was about people. Yeah. And it's always about people when it comes right down to it. And I was like so moved by it, we were like, we're gonna get a typewriter. Like right away. And she was gonna write songs like Bob Dylan used to, you know, and Jack Kerouac and all that. And we were getting a typewriter, and then they had, I don't know if anyone attended the event, but they had these typewriters out in the lobby. We were like, forget the, thank goodness for the computer. Yeah. Typewriters suck. Yeah.
What's that David Mamet movie, State in Maine?
Typewriters, but the people in the movie who care about typewriters, they don't. Suck. Yeah. They are extraordinary people.
Yeah.
And
Tom Hanks was there.
Yeah, and Tom Hanks.
Oh, did he show up for opening night?
No, he wasn't there.
I'm going to segue this somehow. The typewriters into word processors, and everyone can type. You don't need a typewriter to be able to type, right? Anyone has a phone, a computer. So let's segue into democratization of storytelling and equipment. So in a way, today, everyone is a filmmaker, right? Anyone who wants to tell a story, anyone who wants to create a film, can possibly make one. So what is your thoughts on that? Are we swimming in an ocean of films that no one has time to see, you know, other than someone perfecting their craft? What is the use of this? What is beneficial? You know, what do you have to say in that regard?
There is a really great example, and it's already came and went at CIFF this year. A director named Dean Fleischer Camp made a movie. I think they bill it as a documentary, but he took a bunch of YouTube videos of an actual family. This family had documented their whole life, and they had a YouTube channel devoted to their life, their vacations, their backyard picnics, and he took their home footage with their permission and made it into a murder mystery. He concocted one of the most brilliant ideas I've heard in a very long time. He concocted a fake murder mystery using this family's home movies.
He wrote a story with pictures.
Yeah, he's a super talented guy. He's the guy that brings you Marcel the Cell with shoes on. Same guy.
Yeah.
So that's a great example of how this democratization sort of breeds creativity and that's a totally new genre. Like, that's a crazy idea. I didn't get to see the movie, but just reading about it, I was like, this guy's a genius.
Are you talking about Fraud?
No, not Fraud.
Not Fraud. Okay.
I can't recall the title of the film. Does anybody here know what it is?
There's two movies like that?
Yeah. Oh, is that Fraud? Okay, it is Fraud. Okay.
It was interesting. I watched it.
Did you guys like it? I didn't get to see it.
It was awful.
You heard it was bad?
Yeah. It wasn't known to everyone in the theater that that's what he did.
Ah, do you think it would have helped if they did?
Maybe.
Yeah. Well, whatever, I just pimped out a movie that people hate.
It's a
brand. I thought
in concept, that's genius. Yes. I didn't get to see the movie, I just read it on paper, but I think I'll let somebody else answer that question, probably from a different angle, but I thought that was just a really amazing thing.
Yeah, I mean, as educators, educators, cool. There's so much to be said about this, right? Like, do you really need a really expensive camera, or?
No, you don't. I teach ninth grade. I've worked a lot with high schoolers, and the biggest thing that I find that you need to know to be able to make a movie is actually camera language, because I do not want to see a movie from somebody's cell phone, and it's a portrait everywhere. Go landscape, use your third line, where's your headspace, start the language, you know, younger, and so then they know how to actually use the camera language, and then they can start to make skillful images that will tell their stories. But until they know that, then it's just everybody, And that's just, I don't want that.
But I think that the low cost of technology allows students to be able to start doing that much earlier than they used to.
I would have never had a movie without that. I don't own a camera.
Yeah.
I didn't rent a camera. I found incredibly talented students that had really good, they had high definition, mm-hmm. 2K quality stuff that I challenge you to look at and compare to any other documentary and tell me that it was a challenge and a blessing, because we shot on eight different types of cameras. Mm-hmm. So when it came to color correcting, was a whole different story. Mm-hmm. But the quality is there, and it costs nothing, literally. I mean, for me, but for them, a few hundred dollars. Mm-hmm. But the tool, I never found the tool to be the important thing. Mm-hmm. Even though film is absolutely the most technologically, maybe outside of video games, dependent art form, the tool is just the tool. But man, mm-hmm. look at a guy can look at the computer screen and watch a family doing their family video stuff and make a movie out of that. Mm-hmm. Because if he did it right, it's because he knew how to tell a story.
Apparently he didn't.
Yeah. Cheatham said it's
good. Yeah. Anyone has I've seen it. Yeah, it was a very tiring film to watch.
Was
because
it?
It's very noisy. But it is a very interesting thing, especially if you know what you're watching.
Yeah.
And I think the remarkable thing for me about that film, about Fraud, was that the film was interesting itself as it was produced, but it's also the culture of producing a media, recording every aspect of your life and putting it on the web for everyone to consume. I mean, it was a little strange to see the mom on camera like that from the dad's perspective at infinitum. And that was, and of course, like, we all do things like that because we are like a camera-obsessed culture, essentially. We're all members of this culture. And I think that the film made me think of the place of camera in our culture more so than the story that it produced. And of course, I think maybe that was part of its objective. So it was, in that regard, it was successful. Was it a fun movie to watch? No, it was actually very tiring, because it's always like the bad sound of the YouTube videos are always like...
Which actually leads me to one more idea on this subject, which is, you know, yes, you know, the low cost of production, equipment has made it more democratic, has opened up the process. No doubt about that. But I don't think that people are using the technology as well as they can, because they don't really know how.
That's what Jen's
point was excellent.
And I'm thinking about this particularly in audio, right? Oh, if you're working in Adobe Premiere or you're working in any software program, you have an entire range of audio manipulation tools mm-hmm. that no one ever uses. And that's why their stuff sounds so bad.
Mm-hmm. No, sometimes
they don't know where to put the microphone or whatever. Yeah.
But a little limiting, a little. I know this. I talk about this in class, and it's I'm sounding like a broken record a lot. But a little compression, a little EQ, a little limiting, doing some expansion and gating on when you have doing some sound imaging. All of this used to be only available if you could afford an extremely expensive recording studio. Now it's a pull down menu, right? It's like it's a pull down menu, and people won't use it. Mm-hmm. You know, so I keep hearing like low budget stuff that could be a million times better if someone just paid a little attention to the totally free and available sound manipulation elements,
and more importantly, to the element that is literally 50% of the show,
right.
The sound.
Right.
Yeah, I saw Score last night.
It's half the show.
And
I heard
music, we're talking about digital stuff now, but music is, even in a documentary, is...
Yeah, music is our documentary.
I got lucky, I found a musician who did such a fantastic job that, as broke as I am, I flew in from Los Angeles to Cleveland for the premiere because... I can't imagine the movie without his music. I've seen the movie without his music. It's not as good. Mm-hmm. And I went to see Score last night, which is all about these you know, incredibly famous music composers, Elmer Bernstein, Bernard Herrmann, John Williams. I mean, these are the, and you look at the movies that they're scoring and take the score away. They did this great little piece where they showed the Psycho shower scene without the music.
Yeah.
One of the iconic moments in cinema. Cinema, the filmed medium. And if you took the musical score out of it, even though it's Hitchcock,
you can't reenact that scene without going,
No, I know.
I dare you to try.
Jaws the same. Not the, certainly Spielberg would tell you, not the best directing job he ever did, but boy, did he get lucky with John Williams.
And two great notes.
And so don't shortchange sound. Say that really fast 14 times.
And I mean, in defense of Fraud, I feel like I should add this because I don't think it was an error. I think it was part of the aesthetic of the film. But nevertheless, as an audience member, it was tiring to watch. Now, we have talked a lot. I'm going to ask my wrap-up question, and then we're going to open it to the audience to get your questions ready, okay? And my last question is this. The power of documentary in capturing the story of a place. You know, all three films that we're discussing today are capturing the story of this place from people who are from here.
Yeah.
What is the power of that? What is the importance of that? And perhaps this kind of dovetails into the democratization of media a little bit too, right? It's not told by powerful media gurus that are from other cities, other places, but it's being told by Clevelanders,
Jeff's
essentially.
Media guru.
He is kind of, but yeah, he's still a Clevelander. So let's start with Jeff.
I have no such thing.
Just breaking your balls.
I know. I think that... Nice. One more plot for you, Tom. Good job. Well done. I think the success and the power of any movie is its ability to invite the audience in to the point where they can see themselves in the story in some way, shape, or form. And I think that extends to place. You know, capturing a city like Cleveland, and I can speak about a more Civil War specifically, was a rather easy thing to do because we were literally in the middle of it. The thing that's unique about our movie is, for Clevelanders, you are seeing the city like you've probably never seen it before, with 50,000 plus strangers in it, two police officers to every civilian. It's a really bizarre way to look at it if you didn't actually make it down there. So, but I honestly think that depending on what kind of movie you're making, the ones that I tend to make have a lot to do with accessibility and allowing people to put themselves in that place. So you do that through the details. You know, I love close-up videography. When I'm working with directors of photography, we talk a lot about lensing and the minute details that happen. And it's not always about showing somebody's face. Sometimes what they're doing with their hands is more important than what they're doing with their mouth and their face. Sometimes what they're doing and seeing the fine details of that. You know, if you watch the first in our trailer and in the first 2 minutes of our movie, you get introduced to one of my activists, and you're in his bedroom, and he's putting on a bulletproof vest, and he's loading a pistol because he's getting ready to go out to on the street. He had a concealed carry license, so don't worry. But we choose that moment. We're showing you the gun. I mean, it's a close-up of a gun being loaded, and through context, you understand that it's him. And there's moments like that that are really key to telling a story like
that. That's cool.
Yeah. Do you want to talk about Cleveland?
Yeah. So our documentary that we're doing is specifically showcasing the music community, and specifically now Brent actually named the documentary True Voice because it's about singer-songwriters writing their own original music and performing it. And so it's kind of a double, tells it doubly because you have artists who are writing about their perspective of Cleveland, and then you have the music community of Cleveland. So you have like the content through the art songwriter, and then you have the music community. And then right now, again, we don't know the total ending of the story, but the idea is kind of a call to action to support the music community, and just so to showcase it, showcases stories from the musicians and, like, you know, bring support to what's going on in Cleveland.
But I should also mention that when we were looking at our stuff and we were like, okay, so we have people talking and people singing. It's like, this is not a movie. right? This is, you know, Last Waltz and stuff like that, and Decline of Western Civilization, notwithstanding. We were looking at this going like, not really a movie. And what, so what did we do? We went out and we got Cleveland. Because we were like, this story is rooted in a real place mm-hmm. and in the aesthetic of a real place. Mm-hmm. And because we didn't know where else to start, we started with the place and capturing what it looks like and going down and shooting the river, you know, going
city
into
skyline.
The lake and the city skyline and our urban decay and our urban renewal and all of these things, because we felt that somehow in the music of the people who were coming from here, this was in there.
We were going to show the city, yep.
Though we weren't really sure how it was going to fit in. Mm-hmm. And I think there's always a way in which a story is rooted in the reality, a documentary story is rooted in the reality of place, mm-hmm. right? The city, the way it looks, the kind of socioeconomics of it, everything about the city has precipitated the community mm-hmm. that we're trying to capture. And as a result, connecting that community to the city, mm-hmm. to that root, those roots, are a major part of the story. Mm-hmm.
I truly, John, I'm sorry, I'm going to interject something there. I this is something that I feel really strongly about. I mean, if you look at our history, right, the history of African Americans, the history of women, like, youth history was typically was written by from a male perspective, because who was writing the books, who was teaching in colleges, right? I mean, you look at history, what history, whose history are you reading? And I think the story of documentary, specifically that is coming from a place like that I call backyard documentary, actually, mm-hmm. there is so much power in that, even if we don't quite recognize it now, our children, our children's children will get to see a Cleveland that is essentially seen by all kinds of Clevelanders and not necessarily powerful media gurus just like Jeffrey.
You guys are killing me.
This is
the thing that stunned me into making this movie was a place, mm-hmm. a specific, detailed place with a specific aesthetic, and from the poster to the trailer to the all of it, I mean that place, that Wycliffe Italian American Club and those bocce courts and that spot there, right, mm-hmm. which is literally five blocks from where I grew up, that's the movie. And everything of, you know, those details, people need concrete details to grab onto in a film, because film is a very bizarre medium. You're sitting there staring at a flat screen that has nothing to do with reality, and somehow you are convinced you're watching something real, okay? And the only way to make that happen is to give the audience something to grab onto. And that those details, as a filmmaker, those are what make a movie, right? Those are the things that the audience can literally, in their own bones and DNA, feel is true. And as soon as that happens, then you have hooked them. And then you can go anywhere you want and take them anywhere you want. You know, you can do anything you want. But those little details make all the difference.
Even if you go west, right?
Yeah,
you will still end up at east. Thank you so much. I think that was a really exciting conversation. Let's open it to audience. I'm sure people have questions, so let's hear it from you guys.
Or not.
So it seems that you guys started with an idea and a concept of you want to tell a story. But then there seems to also be another form of documentary that, if you consider that like equipment and time is on a slope, and you capture just a part of that and show it from another time, I'm thinking of a crazy one called Hard Rock Parking Lot.
Which
one? Takes place.
Heavy Metal Parking Lot?
Heavy Metal Parking Lot.
So you know, it's a VHS clip of a 1970s concert and the crazy people in the parking lot, and it's like, I don't think you went into that with the story idea, but when you look back at it, the story just jumps out at you. It's like you could never tell that in words. And the VHS concept, you know, aspect of it just like lends a flavor to it. It's like,
oh yeah,
damn, that's cool, you know? And it's like,
that's the documenting aspect of documentary filmmaking. I mean, that's to me what's one thing that might separate it from narrative is that there's this, I don't know, if you had to have the same, you wanted to document these four crazy days in Cleveland that no one knew what was going to happen.
Yeah.
Right? And I want to wanted to document this bocce tournament. I had no idea what was going to happen. And they want to document this musician trying to, you know, survive in the world today. And that's that documentation thing.
Yeah. You pick a great example. Let's talk about Heavy Metal Parking Lot. Because I think you're right. I think there was zero plan going into that. I think somebody went, I'm going to buy a case of Keystone Light, and I'm going to go to this Jeeps pre-show, and I'm going to interview all these rad dudes and chicks that are in the parking lot. But what you come away with is a great edit. And that movie is a great example of meritocracy and something that found an audience much later. Yeah. Because that movie starts to circulate in the early aughts.
Yeah.
And it was shot well before that.
Yeah.
And it was one of those things, it's kind of, Heavy Metal Parking Lot's kind of a freak of nature.
Yeah.
And it's one of those things that, thank God it made it out into the universe, but there are probably so many other movies that are just as good that are sitting in somebody's mom's basement right now.
Yeah.
But that thing is just really expertly put together, because why would you care to walk around a parking lot meeting dudes with mullets, you know, in whatever, 1982.
And wasted chips.
Yeah. So that's like, it's kind of an outlier, you know what I mean?
But it, you know, it kind of makes you wonder if, you know, young film students should not, you know, should film all they can and create a library.
And maybe
capture a time that is invaluable in the future.
Yeah, and I think what we're talking about here too, and it's not the sexiest thing to say, is kind of responsible filmmaking and going, have your shit together, don't throw caution to the wind, because when you have a plan, you at least have something to fall back on. But there are golden moments that happen where there's no plan whatsoever, and be open to those too.
Like Girls Gone Wild?
Yeah.
Interesting documentary series.
Yes. That's great. Nice
stuff. Guy made a shitload of money.
Hey, it's a little like Heavy Metal Park.
By the way, it's very King.
Okay, there's another question. Yes?
Girls Gone Wild.
So this sort of dovetails into that question. I've sort of kind of getting at this aspect, like, a narrative feature film starts with a screenplay, which has a beginning, middle, and end, and everybody, that's sort of like the guidebook for how to make the film, right? Whereas like, it seems like documentary comes at it from a completely different angle. You have this interesting idea that you want to document, and there's like raw journalistic footage that gets gathered, and then the story gets sculpted away from that.
That's exactly right.
And it's just, that's
sculpted
an interesting
away.
Process. And it's sort of also... I feel like documentary filmmaking doesn't necessarily have to have the beginning, middle, and end kind of narrative structure.
I deeply, powerfully disagree.
I'm going to point to an example of a documentary film that I loved, which is, I think it's called Bernard Herrmann's Hands, and the discussion of scoring kind of reminded me of this. It's a documentary of... All it is Bernard Herrmann's hands as he's composing the soundtrack to Vertigo. And the Vertigo soundtrack, and it's 2 hours of this,
and
you're not bored. Like, it's just absolutely
great filmmaker.
And that's all that it is.
I'd be bought.
I'd like to say something. So when I work with like high school students and things like that, we've done documentaries several times. And the problem is I only have a very short window to teach them. So the idea is really just learning how to research, learning how to create questions, learning how to organize interviews, set up lights, just kind of the basic stuff is there. And what ends up happening is, because we have to do it quickly, they document, and then what we have is just a bunch of information. There's like, so like we did a documentary on the government. We interviewed the mayor, local government, we interviewed the mayor, we interviewed all these cabinet members, we interviewed the city council, all these, and it was great, you know, we got B-roll and all the good stuff, and then when you put it together, it's just like, okay, I'm the mayor, and these are my people, and this is how it works, the end. There's no story. So,
I feel like the best documentaries, a lot of times, the conclusions are yet to come. Like, you are, at the end of the film, you're left with
that,
an idea that this
that
is a story that's continuing
too,
to live on. And that's sort of like, I love that, you know, but it's definitely not.
But that's
closing.
At least to this.
It doesn't have
not
a closure.
Just,
yeah.
Exactly.
There's, so it's just kind of a different arc.
Right.
I'm going to go watch that movie.
Open
arc. I'm going to tell you how that story works.
Yeah, I don't want to tell you that.
Yeah.
I don't want to tell you that you're wrong. Is that what he's conducting a soundtrack for a film?
Yeah.
Yeah.
beginning and a middle and end. You may just be looking at his hands, but you're getting that beginning, middle, end. Just don't forget what you're hearing.
Yeah, and then, you know, back to fraud, like that was, like, when you think of it, that story arc is there. Like,
you just hated it.
Well, no, it does seem as though somebody did a really horrible filming job of a story that they had written,
yeah,
and then acted out like this.
That's
really happened with this family.
Yeah.
So it's kind of brilliant that they pulled that off.
Yeah.
I think people left thinking, what a horrible way to tell that story. Without realizing that they had, how they had actually.
Yeah, what the process
was. We're all going to go watch Fraud after this. We're going to go into that filming, right? Using that film that many of us haven't seen as an example. So any other questions, you guys? Yeah, how about you?
So I kind of want to do like filmmaking as a hobby. I don't really want to do it full time. I don't want to like...
Soccer.
No. I don't want to like...
Eat spaghetti.
You know, I don't really want to go to like film school. I have like a full-time job and everything. I don't want to do like the filmmaking like full-time. But like you said, that most people now don't really know where like the pull tabs and stuff are now, and I don't want to be like one of those guys like, oh yeah, I learned it on YouTube.
Why not?
Why not?
Why not?
Tons of stuff on YouTube.
Educate yourself. You don't have to go to school
and
get educated. But in order to do something well, you have to educate at least yourself.
So
otherwise, you're just fucking around.
Yeah, if you don't want to be the guy that learned on YouTube, what do you want to do?
Yeah.
How do you want to learn it? I challenge yourself.
How do you want to learn it? They can't, like, inject it into your head.
Yeah.
Not yet, anyway.
Well, there's also, nofilmschool.com, which is a great, I shouldn't be saying that as the director of the school, but nonetheless, no film school is awesome.
Well, it's a great teaching tool, too. I mean, that's one of the good resources. Yeah, lynda.com for free access to the public library, but there are people who have questions.
Is there, like, a mentorship? Are there people who would be willing to let you follow them around, you know, like, apprenticeship.
It's all a matter of asking, and the short answer is yeah.
Okay.
Oh, definitely.
I'm hearing an opportunity to plug in for our school, right? If anyone is interested in learning how to make films, how to become a filmmaker, the new School of Film, Television, Interactive Media to be would be an excellent option. It's Cleveland State. I'm very proud to teach here. I think we provide an excellent education at an excellent cost, surrounded by really inspiring students and faculty alike. It's a really great place to be, so you should consider it. That's my plug, but it's hard. You know, I'm not a salesperson unless I really believe in what I'm selling.
Well,
like education, then I'm good to go.
I'm not connected to the school at all, but you can see, I'm not from Cleveland, I didn't go to school in Cleveland, but you can see on the stage, these are the professors that are actually making things, which is kind of rare in film school.
It's not rare for
guys. We have 10 minutes. As all
the right, there's a. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was wondering, like, what kind of characteristics do you look at characters who like drive your film? Like, is there like certain type of characteristics that you're like, whoa, like this is what I need to film?
Mm. Who wants to take that one first? Because that's a juicy one.
Yeah, it's a good question. So
I'll tell you what I did. I just asked. I didn't know anything about the details of this community other than this crazy, enormous event. And the semester ended in May, and I called up some people because I was ready to go. And I said, who do I need to talk to? Who do I need to follow? And I listened to a lot of people, and two or three people and I kind of knew who I was looking for, the types I was looking for. And so you just got to listen. Eyes open and ears opener.
I'm so glad you're a professor.
Yeah. I mean, you really you gotta let it wash, and then like a net, certain things get caught in, and you're like, oh, okay, that fish looks like it'll make a good dinner. Oh wait, that one's too small.
I wanted it to grow.
I'm fishing for metaphors.
I would take a little bit of a different approach to that. And just like in a narrative film, what you're looking for is a conflict.
Yeah.
Right? You need a character with a conflict. And that conflict is best if it is both internal and external.
Yes.
right? If there's something within the character that's deeply conflicted and that manifests in their action. And if you could find that, that's the beginning of a character. And they also,
it's the beginning of the story.
They have to have a desire. There has to be something that they want. Because a character who doesn't want something is not somebody who you're interested in watching. So the question becomes, like, you know, what is their problem, internally, externally? What do they want? Why can't they get it? And then what you would also like, if you can, and this is maybe a bonus feature, is a little kind of quirkiness. Something that distinguishes these people from everybody. You know, and actually, we're all quirky. So the quirky thing is only a matter of looking hard enough.
You got to find it as the
filmmaker. Exactly, because everybody's weird.
I had
that's
a character.
That's just the way the world is.
Just to point up that point, I had a character, a main character in this film, who's a fairly boring guy, frankly,
who?
On camera, Brian. But and I love, but he's very. But I found what was interesting about Brian. That was unique, and literally we put all of it on the film, right? And got rid of everything else because I wanted you to, because I love this guy, but on the screen it's a different relationship you're having with the person than in real life. There are things that you're never going to be able to transmit as a filmmaker: smells, tastes, all this, a touch, you know, the vibrations you get off another human being, whatever those things are, right? But Brian had some quirky little things about him, like he played the accordion. He's a bocce player who teaches ninth grade math and plays the accordion. And those are quirky little strange things about him. And they let the audience into Brian. And then you can follow his story, and he has a real arc in the story. But it's, Evan's totally right. You find those little nuggets.
And I'll just piggyback on that. So much of this stuff is trusting your own instinct and trusting your gut. And it's basic questions. Do I like this person? Or do I hate this person to the point where what they're saying is so interesting to me that it's worthy of my attention?
It's worthy of
my hate. I mean, it's really that simple. It's does this, do the words, does this person's presence and the words that come out of their mouth typically, are they something that I care to hear? But if you meet somebody and you're like, I really like this person, that's a good start.
That's how I felt about Brian. I just liked this dude from the beginning.
Yeah.
And it was my job to make you like him the way I liked him. And that was not his job.
I really hated it. So we were doing a documentary on somebody, a musician previously, and I really didn't like him because he was racist, anti-Semitic, and sexist.
Yeah.
And I was like, eh. And I'd go film him, and he'd be like, I'm like, uh-uh. So finally we dropped off.
But I see, and I argue that this character was a very interesting character. An absolutely brilliant musician, but also very, very emotionally disturbed and deeply, deeply flawed in this way. And I felt that was why we signed on for the project to begin with, because this character was so compelling and so interesting, and constantly we were having this argument where Jenny was like, he hates women, he hates black people, he hates Jews, what are you doing? And I'm like, I love that he hates Jews.
As an artist, these are the
things. A lot of times when you're uncomfortable, when you're personally uncomfortable, sometimes that's telling you that you should be there.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that your approach was, no, you have your own personal feelings about it, and I totally get it. Because I've been
trying to make me take Jesus into my heart.
Yeah, I know. It's difficult.
There
I
was
spent
that part.
The entire first day of production of A Morsel of the War, I spent at a pro-Trump rally the entire day. I'm a huge bleeding heart liberal, but I sat there and I listened to Roger Stone and Milo Yiannopoulos and Alex Jones and all manner of complete right-wing wackadoos through a loudspeaker, punctuated by insane songs by 14-year-old Russian girls. Like, it was the most bizarre and disturbing day of my life, but there's some great stuff that comes out. I was uncomfortable and miserable all day. There's some great stuff that comes out.
But you only had 4 days of that.
Oh yeah, for sure. I'm not saying that what you did
was
wrong. Don't get me wrong.
4 days.
Yeah. Don't get me wrong. I'm not suggesting that what you did was wrong, because I totally understand.
It's hard to keep
No, it sucks the life out of you. When you have a character that's like that, and you're like, holy shit.
Well, that was one of those. That kind of dovetailed into that interesting question that came over here about what's off limits.
Yeah.
It's more about what are your limits and where are you comfortable pushing your envelope?
And Jen, if I had to guess, but I think you went, I don't think that this guy deserves to be seen on screen. He's such a despicable human being. And that was the line for you. And that's okay.
I'm wasting my time. I don't want to see
him. Yeah, that's totally okay.
Then I was going to have to edit him.
Yeah. Oh, my God. I don't want to see him. Yeah. No, I get it.
Oh, you better light your subjects.
Another question right here.
Yeah. As directors, what do you look for in an editor to preserve your point of view?
Patience, professionalism, kindness.
Pretty face. Sorry, that was totally uncalled for. And in fact, like, ethically wrong. So,
he's actually the subject of the documentary.
Jen will not make a movie about him. Ever.
No, actually, if I may, and then is somebody who has instincts that surprise you. Right? Somebody who finds an edit, and this was one of the things when we first started working together that I saw in Jen's work, is that she would make edits that I would have never thought of.
Yeah.
And she put stuff together in a way that it was like, oh, yeah, I see that. So you want an editor who's going to bring something more, not somebody who's going to be a projection of you as a director.
Or a director.
Right. Yeah. It's got to be somebody who is going to, like, give you something that you wouldn't have seen otherwise.
But that you wanted the whole time. Right?
That's you just didn't know you wanted it.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to go with a metaphor.
Because that would
be you have to end with a metaphor.
Yeah.
So I think that looking for an editor, a good editor to me is, it's like I look for what I look for in a significant other. Someone who loves you the way you are, who loves your footage the way it is, who accepts it. Right, but also who definitely brings out the best from that. You know, like, you can make friends with people, or you can have significant others who take you places that you don't especially want to go. We all have different versions of ourselves, right? You can be the best you, you can be the worst you, you can be the embarrassing you. So you want someone who's going to bring out the best in you, to bring out the best in the story, who's going to help you and let you sort of grow. Yeah. That's what I look for, and there is no money to pay amount. Like, it's not something. It is more. But I'm a very emotional person when I work, so it's not just about the practicality of it, but it's, you know, how do you measure that? How do you quantify that? Yeah. But that's what I look for when I look for an editor who's going to bring out the best in this story.
The relationship metaphor is a really apt one, because it is. It's an extremely important relationship, and it's tough to quantify, and it's tough to make a list of the things that you want.
You're making a baby.
It's true.
Taking one level up, the metaphors keep going.
You know, I've only worked with another editor like one time recently, and she was really, she listened to me really well, but I ended up like verbally editing this thing to her, you know, like, which I felt really bad about.
You're the director, that's your job, right? The editor's got to know what you want, right?
Yeah, it was like,
well, I'm going
to
tell him.
And just like with the spouse metaphor, it needs to be somebody that you can fight with, mm-hmm. but not fight with.
Yeah.
Somebody that you can challenge and can challenge you back, and there's no hard feelings. That's an extraordinarily part, that's a really important part of that process. Critics. Being like, I hate that you did that. Tell me why you did that. This is what you should do. It's that stuff, because good stuff comes out of that.
Really?
It sucks and it's not fun, but good stuff comes out of this.
The last thing you want is a yes man.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Yeah, that is the editor you do not want. Is the one that you say, oh, make this cut, and they do, and they're like, what do you think? And they're like, yeah, it's good. Yeah. It's like at that
that's
point.
The worst thing you could ever.
No, that is definitely.
But let's end at this note of growth. I love that we're ending this conversation at an idea of growth, even if it is disagreement, even if it is a fight. That's something that brings growth to both people involved and to the story and to the audience, hopefully, right through that story. So I think that is a very powerful note to end the conversation. Let's thank our panelists for coming and thank you. Thank you, guys.
No, we have the other panel coming up. We have the post-production panel coming up. John's editor is going to be on that panel.
She'll tell it like this.
She will tell it like this.